Bob, I have a question for you. I started here in 2014 as an electrician, and someone told me that the power system was ungrounded. What does it even mean? I thought every metal electric box had to have a ground wire connected to it. And the other thing that is different from the facility I came from is these three indicating lights. It seems like most times they're really dim, but sometimes one even goes out and then it comes back.
Well, the big boss said that we're getting an upgrade to our grounding system. He's going to be putting in a new high-resistant grounding system. He said it's going to help us be able to track down all the ground faults. Hopefully, you'll have the answers to all of your questions very soon.
For many years, process industries like pulp and paper, petrochem, and automotive have used ungrounded 480 and 600-volt systems to give them a free ground fault during single-phase cable or motor failures. Today, many data centers are utilizing high-resistance grounded systems to take advantage of the same benefits for fault limitation and continuity of service.
In this video, we will discuss considerations that you should evaluate before operating your system as an ungrounded system. And we will offer you suggestions for using your high-resistance grounding to protect your equipment and reduce the ground fault current on your system.
A majority of power systems are solidly grounded, meaning there's a neutral to ground bond somewhere in the system. Usually, this connection is in the main service transformer, switchgear, or panel board. This is different than equipment grounding, which simply grounds all metal parts of electrical equipment together to protect personnel in case they touch equipment when the equipment is faulty. When a single phase fault occurs on a solidly grounded system, thousands of amps of fault current flow. The fault is cleared by a protective device like a breaker or fuse. This disrupts part of the power system until the protective device is found and reset or replaced after clearing the fault. In addition, with 20 to 100,000 amps of fault current, which may be typical for an industrial facility, significant damage occurs at the point of fault. Ungrounded power systems became popular in the early days of electricity because you could get a free ground fault and less than a few amps of current would flow. Ungrounded power systems, however, require special care and training to ensure personnel know the potential for issues and safety risks. By the NEC definition, basically, if you are not solidly grounded, you are ungrounded.
During a ground fault condition, phase A, for example, goes to ground or zero, and the other two phases go to line-to-line voltage, or 480 volts in this example. It's like having a corner-grounded delta system, but the line-to-line voltage remains the same before and after the ground fault. Since the loads on an ungrounded system are only connected line to line, the loads are unaffected by the ground fault. High resistance grounding has become a great alternative for those looking for service continuity of an ungrounded system, but the added protection and control of a solidly grounded system. By the NEC, high resistance grounding is allowed provided the following criteria are met. The conditions of maintenance and supervision assure that only qualified persons will service the installation. Continuity of power is required, ground detectors are installed on the system, and line to neutral loads are not served.
For power systems that are not intentionally grounded, they are actually grounded through the capacitance of cables, transformers, and power system components, but the capacitive impedance is unpredictable and variable. When a fault occurs on an ungrounded system, usually 1 to 3 amps may flow through the capacitance of the system. Indicating lights let you know you have a fault, but that's it. These lights are 480 volt rated and connected line to ground. During a normal condition, these lights would see about 277 volts to ground on each phase, but during a ground fault, the light on the faulted phase goes out and the other two go to 480 volts and get bright. I've been in auto plants that tell me they've had a ground fault for 6 months and they have no intention of finding it. Basically, to find a ground fault on an ungrounded system, you'd have to turn off one load at a time until the light returns to normal. Very time consuming and disruptive, so honestly, most facilities with ungrounded systems don't bother finding ground faults. If there's a ground fault on an ungrounded system, it's a little bit like this. If I rub my feet on carpeting and build up a static charge, I'm essentially holding a 5,000 volt charge on my finger, and until I touch something or somebody with it, it's not going to discharge. So I hold that DC trap charge. A power system's a lot like that. In fact, power systems are very capacitive if they're ungrounded. On a capacitor that you might use for power factor correction, you would use resistors like these ones to discharge any trap charge that it would retain after the AC power is turned off. A capacitor without a resistor would hold a DC charge like this. If I put a resistor on the cap, it would bleed off like this. So when I put a ground fault on my ungrounded system, the system holds a capacitive charge, and the problem is that if I have an arcing ground fault or an intermittent ground fault, which would be very typical, you could actually see a very high buildup of voltage. Once the line to ground voltage exceeds the insulation rating of the equipment, the insulation will fail and follow through fault current will blow up the equipment. With motors and MOV-based surge protectors, we have seen many failures like this one where the voltage to ground exceeds the MOV turn-on voltage. Remember, a surge protector's job is to clamp the voltage. So if it clamps every single cycle, it will overheat and it will be damaged. For this reason, when you apply surge protection to an ungrounded system, your surge protectors are at risk. When you apply surge protection to a system with an HRG, as long as you specify that it'll be on a line-to-line rated or 480 volt system, for example, it will not be damaged if a ground fault occurs. With a high resistance grounded system, you can set the level of fault current to 3 to 5 amps, for example, by selecting the appropriate resistor. This protects the equipment and bleeds off the capacitive charge that builds up on your power system.
Here at the Experience Center, we can easily demonstrate high resistance grounding and the benefits of this system with a couple different demonstrations, where we can place faults on the power system and motor loads. You can see that a ground fault has occurred by looking at the meter, which will show you a current of 3 to 5 amps, and this indicating light letting you know a fault has occurred. One of the biggest benefits of the HRG is tracking down faults. When a ground fault occurs, I can use this current clamp around the entire conduit. During a ground fault, all of the ground current will not necessarily return through the conduit. There are many ground paths in parallel, and some current will flow in each path. It's kind of like a GFI in your house. The current that flows on the hot has to equal the current on the neutral, or the GFI will trip. This is done with a single current transformer around both conductors. If the currents are not equal, then some of the current is taking an alternate path to ground. With an HRG system, by measuring the entire conduit and all of the conductors within the conduit, when a ground fault occurs, if the sum of the currents in the conduit does not equal zero, then the clamp on and meter indicates a fault. You can follow the fault from the source of power down through the system until you get to a faulted load. This is because there are many parallel ground paths, and all the ground fault current will not flow back through that conduit only. If you clamp on the conduit where there was no fault, the current measurement would be zero. With the pulsing contactor, the change in current is more dramatic and easier to see, so you can ensure that you're on the right path. Note that if the fault is intermittent, the fault goes away. The current reading will go to zero. This light indicates that there is a fault currently on the system. And if you have the switch on manual reset, there has been a fault since the last reset. This is especially valuable for intermittent ground faults. That fault indication can also go to a monitoring system to alert personnel of issues. So in summary, by using high resistance grounding and this clamp on and meter to track down your ground fault, you can have the high reliability that you're looking for. And the HRG doesn't need to be at your incoming service. It can be located at any convenient point on your 480 volt or your 600 volt system. For special applications, for example, to accommodate systems where line and neutral loads are served, simply adding a delta Y isolation transformer will allow you to feed loads like lighting, often fed at 277 volts. Today, designers are looking for highly reliable options for electrical service continuity for industrial power systems and data centers. High resistance grounding offers a great solution for limiting and identifying single phase faults on your power system.
Here at the Power Systems Experience Center, you can see the high resistance grounding system in action and decide if it's right for your power system. Contact us or your local Eaton representative to schedule a visit to the Power Systems Experience Center today and to learn more about various grounding methods, including high resistance grounding.